This training video on basic Unix commands is designed to help you work with the high-performance computing system called ICS-ACI, the Advanced Cyber Infrastructure at the Penn State Institute for Cyber Science. We're going to show you a variety of commands you can use with Unix systems. Just a few reminders before we get started. To perform an action on a Unix machine, you have to type the command, then hit Enter. When you type a command, remember that Unix is case-sensitive. Also, you'll see that some commands include spaces and dashes or hyphens. These are also important. If you leave out a space or a dash, the command won't work. One more thing, you can use most of the commands shown here with the command prompt on a Windows machine or with the terminal on a Mac. This video starts with the most basic commands. After that, we'll cover the Unix commands for operations on files. Finally, we'll look at Unix commands for running executables. Let's start with the command ls. This command lists the contents of the directory you're working in. The different colors denote different types of folders and files. Note that the meaning of the various colors is not standardized. LSA is an option of the ls command. It displays the files that are normally hidden, along with other files. Here, the formerly hidden files that are now shown on screen are the ones that start with a dot or period. Hidden files usually contain configuration data for applications or utility history information. The command cd with a directory name changes the working directory from the current directory to its subdirectory. If the directory you want to work in is in your current working directory, just type its name. If the directory you want is outside your current directory, you'll have to enter the full path. In this example, we're in the directory test repo. We're using the ls command to check the content of the directory, and then cd to change to the subdirectory. Notice that you can hit tab while typing a file name or a command to automatically complete what you're typing. If there are more possible endings, they'll be suggested to you. Here we use tab to find a file with a very long name. The cd dot dot command moves you up one directory in the hierarchy of the file system. Use cd dot dot forward slash dot dot to move up two directories, and so on. The command mkdir creates or makes a subdirectory in the current working directory. The command mv moves an item to a new location. MV operates on both files and directories. When you use it on a file, MV renames the file to a new name. The command cp makes a copy of a file in the directory specified. If you need to copy the entire contents of one directory into another directory, use the copy command with option R. By the way, you'll see this R option used with other commands. It generally makes the command execute in a loop until it reaches all the files or directories on the last node of the current directory. So that's how to move and copy with cp and mv. Here's how to remove and find files and directories. The command rm, used with the file name, removes or deletes the file. To remove a non-empty directory, use the command rmr with the R option. The command rmrf will delete the entire contents of the file system on the machine you're working on, so you'll want to be very careful about your use of this command. Find name searches for directories with the same name in the current directory and its subdirectories. In the example here, we're searching for a directory named foo. If a directory with the same name exists, the full path will be displayed. Find path with the option name finds a particular directory in the specified directory and displays its full path. If no path is shown, it means there is no directory with that name. Here, we're looking for the directory named Python in the local directory. If you use the command find path name with asterisks before and after what you're searching for, it finds the directory you requested from among the directories in a specified directory and displays the full path. The command grep is also a find command. It finds the lines of a file where a particular pattern of characters appears and displays them. The command chmod plus an option can be used to change the read, write, and execute permissions on a file or directory. Here are some options you can use. You can define to whom the permissions apply, a single user, you, a group, G, or all others, O. You can define whether the permissions are added, plus sign, or removed, a minus sign. And you can define the types of permissions, read, that's R, write, W, or execute, X. The example shown here uses the options U, G, W, X, and the plus sign to assign, write, and execute permissions to a particular user, that's you, plus a group, G, on the directory called results2. Note that assigning permission to others, the O option, makes the file public and open to changes by any user, so be cautious about using this option. By the way, here's a useful tip. Use the up-down arrows to scroll through the history of the commands you've entered. Also note that in Unix, you cannot use the familiar keyboard commands Ctrl-C and Ctrl-V for copy and paste. Instead, highlight the text you want to copy. Now, right-click on the highlighted text, and from the drop-down menu, choose Copy. Right-click on the place where you want to put the text. From the drop-down menu, choose Paste. In Unix, most programs and many protocols, functions, and file formats have accompanying manuals. Use the man command to retrieve information from the manual and display it on screen. Here we're using the man command to see the manual page for the command grep. Now you can use the up-down arrows or page up and page down to scroll through the text in the manual. Use Q to quit the manual and return to the prompt. Another way to see the manual page for the commands is by using dash dash help after a command. But this works only for bash commands. Now let's look at some useful Unix commands for operations on files. Use the command cat with a file name to display the contents of the file on the screen. The command less with the file writes the contents of the file onto the screen one page at a time. Here you're seeing the end of the first page of the file. You can press spacebar to see the next page, or press Q to quit reading. The command more is similar to the less command. More also writes the contents of a file to the screen one page at a time, but it allows for only limited backward movement through the file. Use the command head with a number and then the file name to display the first lines of the file on screen. You specify the number of lines. In the example here on the screen, notice that each new line in the file is indented. If you don't specify the number of lines, the first 10 lines of the file will be displayed automatically. If you want to see the lines at the end of the file, use the command tail with a number. The number of lines you specify will be displayed on screen. Again, if a number is not specified, the last 10 lines will be displayed. If you want to clear the screen, this one is simple. Use the command clear. The command cat with two file names combines the contents of the first file and the second file and displays the output on the screen. Here the term cat comes from the word concatenate, which means bind together. Use the greater than symbol to redirect the output of a command. from standard output, that is, on the terminal screen, to the output defined by the user, for example, a file. Here's an example of how this works. We're using the command cat to join the contents of the file tdf and the file mri-newav2lc. We use the greater than symbol to write the combined content to a new file called total. To view the file called total, use the less command. You can use the double greater than symbol to append the output of a command to a file. Here we're using the symbol with the cat command. If you don't specify a file name after cat, the input will be read from the keyboard and appended to the total file. You can hit enter after each new line if you want to append it to a file. To stop, go to the new line, press Enter, and then press Control plus sign D. Here we're using the tail command to check. You can see two new lines added to the file total. And now we're using the clear command to clear the screen. You can use the command sort to sort either alphabetically or numerically. Here, we're sorting the contents of the file names alphabetically. We can write the output to a new file called snames using the greater than command. This command, a vertical bar, symbolizes a pipe or pipeline. Use it to take the output of your first command and use it as input for a second command. In this example, the cat command joins the file names with a new file, names2, and writes it into the output. The vertical bar command takes the output of the cat command, which is the combined list of names, and applies the sort command to that output. The result is an alphabetically sorted list of names from the two files combined. The origin of the command tar is the term tape archive. Use the command tar cvf to build an archive file. To explain the options you see here, C is for create, V is for verbose, and F is for file. Here you can see the output of the V option, the list of files added to the archive arch_g77tar. The command tar xvf is the opposite of tar cvf. It extracts the archive file1.tar and names it file1. Here you see files stored in an archive extracted into a folder, g77. ZipR builds a zip archive from a directory. The R option allows you to add not only files, but also directories to the archive. Unzip extracts the zip archive to the directory. The command gzip compresses a file. Note that the original uncompressed file is not preserved. Also, gzip works only on files, not on directories. Gunzip does the opposite of gzip. It uncompresses the file. Finally, let's take a look at some useful Unix commands for running executable files. The command ldd with an executable file lists the shared libraries required by the program specified. Here it's mri-newa. What you're seeing on screen is that the symbolic link, libgfortran.so3, points to the location of the library. Symbolic link, or soft link, is the file that contains information about the full path of the target file. It's included in a compiled code in order to show the loader where to go to get a required shared library code. In this way, LDD can serve as a good diagnostic tool. Errors in linking, like symbolic links used during compilation, which are not linked to any real library, may be the cause of problems when you're attempting to execute or compile programs. LNS creates a symbolic link, or soft link, to the file for which the path is given, the target. Finally, LSL displays detailed information about the contents of the current working directory. That's a lot of commands to remember. Here's a helpful tip for keeping these commands at your fingertips. Search for an online cheat sheet of Unix commands and make it your desktop background. This has been an introduction to the basic commands you'll need to work on ICS-ACI when you're using a Unix system. We've got more training videos on our website, ics.psu.edu.